So we will start with the data types. Data types in Python. Okay, so we will start with the numerals first. So the topic we are going to start today is, first we are going to start with the numerals. In the numerals you have integers, then you have floats, then you have complex numbers. Okay, then we are going to discuss with the string data type. In the string data type we are going to discuss the methods related to it. Then we will be going to the none, and then we will be going to the boolean data type. Okay, so these all are the fundamental data types. Next, we have derived data types. Now, in the derived data types, what all derived data types we have? We have list, then we have tuple, we have dictionary, then we have set, frozen set. Then byte array, then range. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 6, 14. Total 14 data types we have. Okay. So these all are the different data types which we are going to start with today. I'll start covering from the very first data types. We'll be starting with integer, float, complex, and then we will be covering the other data types. So this is going to hardly take around half an hour, maximum half an hour. And then we'll be going to discuss with this string. Probably today whole class will be dedicated to this string, because string, in that string we'll be discussing everything about this string, like the basic operation which we can perform on this string, indexing, slicing and all. And then we will be going to the next part, which is the methods related to this string. And if time permits, then we'll be covering the other data types, which are none and boolean. Probably tomorrow we'll start with the derived data types. Okay, so let's start with it. So first of all, we are going to start with the integers. Now, what all integer, what is an integer? So any number without a decimal point is integer. Okay. Any number, if you are taking, which is without a decimal point, is an integer. For example, 10, minus 10, or zero. Positive value, negative value, or zero, everything is an integer value. Okay, fine. Now, next thing, integer can be represented in different format. Okay, so there are different a representation of the integer value. For example, there is a binary representation. In the binary representation, the values should be preceded by 0b small or 0b capital. Okay, and the allowed digits are 0 and 1. Okay, fine. Clear? Now, to convert any value to binary, we have bin function. Okay, fine. In this you can pass any value, decimal, octadecimal, octal, hexadecimal, or binary, any value to convert it into the binary equivalent. Okay, Fine, everyone. Now, the example of the binary values are, for example, you may write 0B1010. This is the binary representation of 10, or you may write 0B1010. This is the binary representation of 20. Okay. Similarly, we have the octal representation. Remember, only integers can be represented in these forms, not the float value. There is another representation, that is the octal, and the values should be preceded by 0O small or 0O capital. Okay. Now, allowed digits in the case of allowed digits are 0 to 7. Okay. And to convert any value to octal value, we have the corresponding function is OCT function. Okay. Now, the example of this is, for example, 007654. This is the octal representation of any number. We'll see how we can get this decimal equivalent of this octal value or binary value. We'll be looking at it in some time. Now, in the hexadecimal representation, the value should be preceded by 0 small x or 0 capital X. Okay. Allowed digits are 0 to 9 and A to F. Okay. Now, to convert any value to the hexadecimal format, we have hex function. Okay. And the corresponding values we have is, like, you know, the sample value we have is, let's say, 0xfc98. Okay. Now, let's see. So, representing decimal value in binary value. Representing a decimal value in binary value. Okay. So we have A is equal to 100. This is the decimal value, right? 100 is the decimal value. If you want to convert this decimal value into the binary value, you have to, or you want to represent it into the binary format, you may just write A. It will give you the binary equivalent of 100, which is 0B11100100. Okay, fine. Now, let's say if you want to convert any binary value to the decimal, so binary to decimal, then what you can do, you can write that binary value directly. You can print that binary value directly. For example, if you will be writing this 0B11001100, so it will be giving you the decimal equivalent only. Okay. So if you are directly printing it, then it is giving you the decimal value. Or you may also do this way. This is one way of getting the decimal equivalent. The other way is, you may write B is equal to the same value and you may print B. Okay. It will be giving you the decimal equivalent. Fine. So there is no specific function. Or the third way of doing the same thing is, you can use the int function around this. So you may write int of this binary value. That will also be giving you the decimal equivalent of this binary value. Okay. So these are the different ways of getting the decimal equivalent of any binary, octal or hexadecimal. Okay, fine. Now, so we have seen this is the binary representation. Let's say if you have a octal representation, then what will be the how we can represent it? So representing an octal value in binary value. So let's say we have 0007654, and to represent it into the octal form, we have the OCT function. Okay, sorry. We have 7654. This is, or let me write some random value, 9876. Okay, so like this is a decimal value. 9876 is a decimal value. And if you want the octal representation of this decimal value, then you have the OCT function. If you will be running this code, it will be giving you the octal representation of 9876, which is 23224 in the octal representation. Now, if you want to convert any octal value to the decimal value, then what you can do, you can simply write this octal value inside the print function. This way you can do that, okay? You can uncomment it. This will give you the 9876 of any octal value, or you can assign it to a variable and then you may print it. That is also another way of doing that. So that will also give you the same thing, or else you can pass it to the int function. That will also be giving you the same thing. Okay, fine. So this is the different way of representing the values into binary and octal. Okay, and conversion from one form to another. Is that clear? Fine, everyone. Yes. Now yes, we yes. can represent a yes. Any question?
Okay. Abhishek, Deepak is said. You told like for octal representation, the allowed digit is 0 to 7, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you, yes. But you take the example, a equal 9876, and you.
This is a decimal value. I'm converting this decimal value to octal value. So octal representation is this one. Here, you will not get any digit outside of 7. Okay? Yeah. Now we have hexadecimal value. Now hexadecimal value to... Sorry. Decimal value to octal. Decimal value in octal. Next, we have decimal value to hexadecimal value. Okay, now, so let's say we have 64664. Okay, this is the decimal value. And if you want the corresponding hexadecimal value, I can write hex function here. Now, if you will be uncommenting it and executing it, you will get the corresponding hexadecimal representation of 64664, which is FC98. Okay, so now let's say if you want this decimal representation of this hexadecimal value, so you can pass it to the print function. So hexadecimal. If you will be executing this code, it will be giving you the decimal equivalent of this hexadecimal value. Okay, so there are three different ways where you can use this, like, you know, anyone you can use it, and everyone will be giving you the decimal equivalent of that hexadecimal, octal or binary. Okay, now the question is, where do we use this representation? So we are not going to use it, but yes, there might be some program related to this which you will encounter, or the kind of assignment you will be getting. So you should remember this function. And in fact, these functions are useful, may be useful in few cases. So you should know that what these functions does and what exactly their output is, in case if you find this function somewhere. Okay, these all are the built-in functions and we need to learn about them. Okay, fine. Now, one thing you need to remember, only one point, is that integers values only can be represented in this format, means binary, octal or hexadecimal. You cannot represent any other value in this format. Okay, fine. Now, in the integer, the next topic we are going to discuss is, there is no concept of size. There is no concept of size in integers, okay? Or you can say in Python, okay? For now, what does it mean? So you don't have the short data type. You don't have the long data type in Python. You don't have the double data type in Python. You don't have the carry type in Python, okay? So why is it so? So if you will look at the values, for example, a is equal to 10. And if you are looking at the values, let's say b is equal to quite a bigger value. So in Python, any value which is, using the decimal representation, that is an integer. Okay. So it doesn't matter how big, how small value you are. It is an integer type. Okay. If it is an integer value or number, then it is an integer type. Import sys. And if you will be checking the size of this, sys.get size of a, okay? And similarly, if you will check the size of b, then in that case, if you'll check, see automatically this, as we know that in Python memory management happens automatically. So how much memory is required for this 10, that will be decided by the PVM, and the minimum amount of memory which is required to store any integer is 28 byte of memory, and it is allocating 28 byte of memory. Now Python is a runtime. At runtime, it checks that what value you are allocating to a variable, since it is quite a bigger value, so it is allocating 72 bytes of memory for this larger value. Clear, everyone? Fine. So it is not a compile time where you have to specify the data type at the compilation stage only. Here, everything will be checked at the runtime, and at runtime, your PVM will decide that how much memory will be allocated for this particular object. Is that clear, guys? Any question?
Sys is a library
built-in library in Python, which allows you to access the Python functionality into your on your operating system.
Okay.
Fine. So, like.
So Abhishek, where we can use this is function?
There are a number of locations. So you can use it let's say if you want to interact with your system, you can use this sys module. Okay. So if you will look at the definition of the sys module, so it says that it provides the access to some variables used or maintained by the interpreter, and to function that interact is strongly with the interpreter. Okay, so you have this Python interpreter which is running on top of your operating system. Okay, so if you want to look at some variables or functions of this Python interpreter, then you need this sys module. For example, I want to interact with this interpreter and I want to check that how much size or what is the size of the value associated with A, right? So I want the internal internal information which is pertaining to PVM or the interpreter, isn't it? Right? Which is pertaining to Python virtual machine or Python interpreter, right? Because Python interpreter is only responsible to allocate the memory for this A variable, right? Or for this this value or for the B variable, isn't it?
Yes. Right?
So if we want to we want to access those variables or the functions, then we take the help of the sys module.
Okay. Got it.
So basically, in other words, you can understand that if you want to interact with the Python interpreter, you can use the sys module. Okay.
Sys is a module, right?
Yes, sys is a module.
Okay. And Abhishek, what is the difference between function and module?
Function, let's say this print is a function, okay? And this file name or file is a module.
Okay, so file name is the module.
File is the module.
Any other example of module?
For example, math is a module, or let's say if you are saying sys is a module, right? So whatever module you are saying, that module is actually a file existing on your system. That module or that file you are importing here to use the functionality defined in it. And function is what function will be inside the module. So for example, here I may define one function, def f1.
Hey Abhijit, is a library of C or Java is comparable to module of this Python?
Yes, library of
Java or C.
I cannot give you the confirmation on that, but yes, you can say Python. C file or Java file can be used as a module in Python. Let's say if you have,
because we have code, like APIs, for example, what we would say in Java is import dot java dot util dot.
Yes, correct. So those that's what I'm saying, that those packages, whether you'll be able to import as a module in Python or not, that confirmation I cannot.
No. I'm not saying like we should import them. I'm just asking, is it comparable in the sense what is module in Python? I mean, what is library in Java? is that equivalent to module in
this? Yes, you can say that module.
Okay. Because it is functionality written outside, but we, whenever required, we will import or we will use in this particular our program.
Yes. Like header files in C is similar to the modules in Python.
Okay, got it. Yeah. Okay, got it.
So you have the libraries, right? You say library in Java, right?
That's correct. Yeah.
Yeah. So yes, library is equivalent to the modules in Python.
So Abhishek, you were explaining like a function is coming inside the module that you are
explaining. Yes, a function comes inside the module. For example, let's say, see it here. Print help of integer. So this is the integer class. Okay. Now in this integer class, you have lots of methods which are defined. These all are the functions. Okay. They are defined inside a class, and this class is defined inside a module. Which module? That may be the some built-in module inside the Python, like double underscore built-in double underscore we have. It may be defined in that. But function is basically what it is. You can say it is a function or method which will be written inside a file which you can use to perform some task in some other module. Okay. Like for example, let's say if you take this get size of function, it is a function defined inside this sys module. So you can think of this sys as a file, and inside that file, this get size of function is defined.
Yes, Abhishek, got it.
Understood.
Abhishek, Yashika here. I think we can create our own module also by using defining the function, right?
This is one module, no? This is our own module.
Okay.
We will be importing it into some other module.
Okay, fine.
Okay. So the thing I was discussing is there is no concept of size in Python. It means you don't have short data type, you don't have long data type. Why? Because see, short, long, double, and all these things is required when you go to C and Java, that those all are the compiled language. And at this stage of compilation, you need to specify the data type, because at the compilation stage only, they allocate the memory and the resources to the variables and to the data which you are using. Okay, at the time of compilation. Here, that part is done in the runtime stage. So at runtime, it will check that what value you are assigning, and based on that value, the memory will be allocated for that object. Okay. So it is checking at runtime, right? So at runtime, it will allocate the memory. Now at runtime, it will check what is the size, and accordingly, it will allocate the memory, because here we don't have to, we are not specifying any data type, right? We are not writing it is an integer type, it is an integer type. If you'll check the type of A and B, both will be coming as integer type. No one will be coming as long type. For example, if you will write print a type of A and type of B, both will be coming as integer type. Okay. Whereas in the other programming languages, this value you cannot store in the integer type. You have to specify it as a long type. Okay.
Abhishek, one question. Basically, you know, for example, we can assign A equal to 10, and similarly, we can assign A equal to some floating point number as well after some time in the program. So initially, when you assign 10 in the first statement, it will allocate some memory. Later, I mean, when you are assigning different data type to it, it will allocate some memory. So how about the old memory allocated to that A? Will it go away, or it will still be there? Any idea? I mean, I'm not asking an answer, but if you know,
let memory is not memory. When I'm saying that memory is allocated, memory is not allocated to A. Memory is allocated to the object 10. This is the object for this memory will be allocated. A will be pointing to this memory.
A will be, A will be referencing to that object where 10 is stored. Yeah, that I understood. But later we are storing something else to A, which requires a longer size, basically. That means this
this value only. Okay.
Yeah,
let's say this value only.
Yeah, we are
writing A equal to this. Okay.
Yeah, we are assigning it to A. Now, what happens to that 10? Will it be memory or
automatically selected? Since the reference count for this 10 will be reaches to 0, right? See, let's understand how these values are stored in Python.
Okay, nobody is referring to 10.
Yes, yes, yes.
So what will happen in that time?
That value will be automatically garbage collected. So that the place where 10 was stored, that memory will be freed. Okay, 10 will be deleted from the memory and it will be freed. Okay.
Oh, excellent. Okay. Okay. Got it. Yeah. I mean, it's a useful concept basically when we are dealing with big programs. Because otherwise, if it is not garbage collected, it will create a heap issue basically.
Yes.
Memory.
So after some time, your heap will be, you know, packed with unused objects.
True. Yeah, this is very useful for running larger applications. Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Abhishek.
Yes, Shubhangi.
So that 28 is the size of memory that A is occupied. The value of A.
The object inside A, okay?
Yeah, that 10 numbers.
Yes, yes, exactly.
10 number, how much memory occupied is 28, right?
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Now, but the question is here, don't you feel, compared to other programming languages, Python is taking much memory to store a single number? Yes, it is.
Yes.
And why it is so? Why? Because let's say if you will store this 10 on in C or Java, so hardly it will take around 8 bytes. Or in the last class, someone said that it might be occupying 2 bytes of memory.
Yeah, that's okay. True. It occupies 2 bytes per shot.
Yes. So let's say if it is 2 bytes of memory only, here it is taking 28 bytes of memory. Now, what happens actually when you store Python? So it stores some other information. I don't know whether I have discussed it in the last class. So it stores some other set of information. For example, let's say this is object. I have discussed it.
Yes. Reference count size.
Yes. So integer object head, and this will be storing few other information. For example, it will be storing the data, which is 10. And then it will be storing the reference count. Then it will be storing the size. Then it will be storing the type, okay? All the information which is required for this particular data type, like integer object, all those information will be stored here. And since it is storing this much information, actually it requires 28 bytes of memory to store the minimum amount of memory. Let's say if you take 10, 20, it will require 28 bytes of memory. And as you will increase this data, this size of the memory will keep on increasing because it is going, data is growing larger and larger, right? So it will require more amount of memory. Clear? Fine?
Yeah, I think everything in Python is an object. In Java, there are basic data types like int, float, and all those things.
Yes.
So they are basic data types. I think this is an object.
Yeah. Okay.
Abhishek, A will be then holding the address to 10. I mean,
yes, address of 10. Correct. Okay. A will be holding the address of 10.
Okay.
Haven't I discussed that memory management?
Abhishek, one quick question. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Just give me a second.
Yeah.
Have I discussed the memory management in Python?
In the special class you have.
Special class.
Okay. Let me discuss it here. Let's see what happens, how the memory is managed in Python. So basically the memory management in Python is automatic. What is memory management? So memory management is basically memory allocation and deallocation. Okay, and it is completely automatic. Okay, memory management is completely automatic in Python. Now what happens, let's say, let me write one program. So we have A is equal to 10, B is equal to 20, C is equal to A plus B and print C. Okay, so first of all, we are going to discuss about the memory allocation. Now we know one thing, that this, let's say if you are going to run this Python code, it is also a kind of application, right? So some amount of memory will be allocated to this application when you, your program will be running into that amount of memory only. Okay, so one minute, let me draw the paint here. Okay, so what happens, first of all, let's say this is your RAM. And in this, your OS is already running here. This is your operating system, okay? And you have started f1.py, so operating system will allocate some memory here for this. And let's say the memory allocated for that is some amount of MB, like you can say this is f1.py is running. And what is f1.py? f1.py is nothing but the same code. So A is equal to 10. B is equal to 20, C is equal to A plus B, and print C. Okay, this is the code which we have. And this code is nothing but f1.py. Okay, now, so this code is running where? This is your code which is running inside this memory, right? Now we have to enlarge this memory. So when you will enlarge this memory actually divided into four parts internally. It will have four parts. The first one will be the code area. Next, we will be having the variable area. Next, we will be having the heap area. And the last one, we will be having the stack area. Okay, so this first one, as I said, it is the code area, which is fixed size. It will be a variable, which is used to store all the global names inside your application. What are the global names you have? A, B, C, these are the global names which you are using. Okay, now what is heap area? Heap area is used to store all the objects in idea. Okay, and next we will be having stack area. So stack area is responsible to resolve the order in which functions will be executed, one, and second thing, to store the local variables. Okay, stack area will be used to store the local variable, or you can say the references of the local declaration. Okay, object will always be stored into the heap area, whether it is defined in local or in the global. Okay. Now, what is the local and what is the global, that I'll be discussing in with respect to this program. Now, out of these four areas, code area and stack area, I'll be discussing stack area later when we will be going to the functions. Code area is not that much useful. It is fixed in size, and the code which you are executing, that code will be loaded into the code area. Okay, your code size which is required is fixed, right? Why? Because once you start executing it, it will not require the extra amount of memory, right? Once whatever the code size is there, it will fit into this code area. Okay, it will not grow. Okay, but yes, your objects inside your program may grow. Okay, so heap objects will start running this free area. So if you require extra heap area or extra stack area, then they will be keep on expanding in these directions. Okay, fine everyone. Now let's see, if you will execute this code, then what will happen? So first of all, you will be executing this first line of code, right? A is equal to 10. So whenever you execute this kind of assignment statement, the value on the right hand side first gets executed. So this is the 10. This 10 will be stored into the heap area. Okay. And let's say the ID for this is 101. Now A will be pointing to this ID of 10. So A is stored into the variable area, and the ID associated with this A is 101. Okay, fine. Next, you will be executing the second line of code. In this second line of code, you will be storing this 20.
is true here again, and let's say the ID is 102. Okay, so B will be pointing to this ID now. Okay. Next, let's say you have this third value, third line which will be executed. So in this first, it will execute this expression on the right hand side. It will check this A is available. So see, this is the reason where we need to give the name to any value in the Python. Why? Because if you will not give the name, then how you can do this operation? So what happens here when you have written A plus B? So actually it will check whether A and B are existing into the variable area or not. Yes, it is existing. Then it will check what is the ID. So it will replace the ID here 101 and 102. Then it will fetch the value at those ID, which is 10 and 20. And then it will add those values. So the new value which will get created here is 30. Let's say the ID for this object is 103. Okay, so C is now pointing to 103. Okay, C is now pointing to 103. Now, if you will be coming and executing this code, so first it will go and check what is the ID associated with C. It is 103, so it will fetch the value at 103 and it will print 30 on this screen. This is how this code will be executed. Okay, now if you see here, so 10, 20, and 30, they all are existing, right? These all are existing. So this is the memory allocation. Now, how memory deallocation will be done? So as of now, there is one reference of 10, there is another reference of 20, and there is one reference of 30. So this object garbage collection will not happen for this object. Okay, but let's say if you will delete the reference of C. Remember, you cannot delete the object. You don't have any control over the heap area. You cannot control heap area. You cannot write delete 30 or delete 10 or delete 20. You cannot delete the objects. Only PVM can control this heap area. Okay, fine. Now, but you can control the variable area. So as soon as you will write del C, so it will delete this reference. Okay, now since this reference is deleted, so 30 is having no reference now. So reference count for this is to previously it was 1, now it is 0. So as soon as this reference count reaches to 0, this object will be garbage collected and this memory will be free. Okay, fine everyone. Is it clear, guys?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So this is how the memory allocation happens. Now you have the Thorny editor. You can execute this kind of codes or any code which you are writing. Try to use the Thorny editor. Write the code into the Jupyter notebook. But if you don't understand or if you get stuck somewhere, copy paste the code into the Thorny editor. Or you can do one more thing. You can copy paste. This is also a good website where you can execute your code and you can visualize it. Okay. So now, if you will be executing this code, so just see how it is executed. A is created, B is created, C is created, and now you are printing C. So it is printing 30 now, del C. So reference of C is deleted, del A reference of B is, that means reference of basically 30 and 10 is deleted. Okay. Since B is not deleted, so B is still existing in the memory. Okay. Fine. Clear, everyone? So this is one where you are not able to see the heap area and all stack area and the variable area separately. But yes, this same code, if you will write into the Thorny editor, then you can probably able to visualize it in a better way. So let's see that. You can visualize the same code into the Thorny editor. So we have this code. Now I'm going to debug it. I'll be executing it line by line. First of all, first line. And then in that also, first right hand side part will be executed. So this yellow line says that we are executing that particular part. So we'll be coming on the right hand side first. We are on the right hand side. Executing it, 10 is created into the heap area. You can see here, this is the heap area. And the ID for that is 10C40. Now A will be pointing to this ID here. Okay. Now let's execute the second line. 20 is created into the heap area. ID is 10D80. B will be pointing to this ID into the variable area. Next, C is equal to A plus B. So first it will fetch the ID of A, then B, and then it will fetch the value and add these values. So new value will become 30. The ID is created 10EC0. Now C is pointing to this ID in the variable area. Correct. Now you are printing C. So this will create a none object. Why? Because this is a none is the object which is created whenever you call this print function. Okay. So this function returns none. So it is creating that object. We'll discuss it later in the function. As of now, let's see this del C. When you are executing del C, so reference of C is deleted. Now, if you are deleting the reference of A, reference of A is also deleted. And now, if you will complete the execution, if you will complete the execution, 1 minute. Okay, so let's execute this. Now, if you complete the execution, you will see that 10 and 30 are deleted from the heap area, and also A and C are deleted from the variable area. Why? Because these references were deleted from the variable section. Okay, fine. So this is how memory is allocated into the heap area. Main is the heap area. All the objects, almost everything in Python is an object, and all the objects will be stored into the heap area. You can manage, if you want to do the memory management, you have a control over an extent over the variable area. You can control this this particular area, and then you can manage the heap area accordingly. Okay, but you cannot manage the heap area directly. Clear?
Yes.
Abhishek, we have deleted C and A manually, but if we don't delete, then it will stay in the memory.
Yes. So let's say if you will comment it and if you will execute it, then you will see that they are existing in the memory. Okay.
Abhishek, do we have a common function to delete or deallocate all the datas or variables we have used?
No, we have to use del attribute. Del function, del attribute.
Abhishek, if we reallocate one of the variables, say A, then the value of 10 will be removed from the heap memory or it will be shown?
Sorry?
If we reallocate the value of A, A equal to 50 something.
Okay. You are 1 minute. You are saying A is equal to 50, right?
Yes.
Okay. So when you are writing A is equal to 50, so reference of 10 is not there, right?
Yes.
So if you're executing it, so see, 10 is not there, 20, 50, 70 is there.
Okay.
So Python internally gives a reference count, okay, for every object.
Abhishek, I mean, after some time, of course, this particular program execution is done, but if it is a web application, after some time, if we are not using A and B, so memory will be garbage collected, right? If it is a web application.
It is not about not using. It is about the references. Okay, reference count. Memory reallocation happens only on the reference count.
Okay. Now, if A points to something else,
yes.
Earlier object will be gone.
Yes.
Okay.
So, till what time A, B, and C will stay in the memory? I mean, if I'm not deleting it manually, then?
Then till your program is running. Once you will close the program. So, all the objects which you have created, that is done. Your program execution is completed, so that memory will be released.
Okay.
In this simple kind of programs, as soon as running ends, I think it will be gone.
As soon as it ends, it will be released.
Okay. Yeah, it matters when we are executing web applications where it will be application will be running and trying to get the request.
In the Python, when you discuss about the web application, so this is not the, you are not going to consider only the Python features. You are going to consider the Django features also. Okay, and Django is much more complex than many other web packages. Why? Because a lot of things are built-ins, and we need to understand it in detail. If you want to understand the memory allocation, deallocation when you are using Django in while designing the web application.
Abhishek, which is more beneficial? Is memory allocation during compiling time more beneficial, or is it if it is allocated during the runtime, is that more beneficial?
See, it is not. I cannot say which one is beneficial. It all about the use. So for example, if you will talk about, like, you can understand this way that performance wise, Python cannot be comparable with C anytime because of that compilation feature only in C. Okay, and Python is interpreted and it is a runtime language. Okay, so what happens, it compiles the code and then it executes the code. So there is a two level of translation happening here in the Python. Okay, and in C it happens only compilation, right? And everything is done in the compilation stage. So every language has their own limitation. For example, I don't think those who are from Java or C, correct me if I'm wrong, can you represent or can you write this much big value in C or Java?
I personally, I don't think so. Like you are saying,
no,
like
we have to change the data type to long.
No, long also.
We have to change the data type to long.
Long also has a limit. No. 2 to the power 64 minus
yes.
1.
It will have
the limit for, correct?
Yes, it will have.
So it will not be able to represent this in other languages, right? And here, since it is not the compile time, you are not specifying the data type here. So you can use any big number, doesn't matter how big, how small it is. Okay. So if you remember, those who remember long, let me find it. It is around. It will be coming around this much. Okay, now I think 2 to the power 63, I hope. Yes, this is the largest number which you can represent in C or Java, what I remember. Is it? Am I correct?
That must be true. That must be correct.
Correct. Whereas in Python, you can take any big number, doesn't matter. Why? Because it is not checking the value. It is taking the. It is taking it as an object, integer object, and that integer object can be anything. No. Okay. So every language has their own advantages and disadvantages. In that way, we cannot compare. Like, see, we know that there are needles also, and there are sword also. So both are not used in the same cases. For example, still, if people want to develop the kind of banking applications and some kind of if I'll take the example of banking application, clients will prefer Java only, or many people will prefer Java over Python. Why? Because you have a lot of security features which you can handle as a developer in Java, which you don't have in Python. Okay, so still we are working on it. Python probably will be evolving a lot in the upcoming days. And it is picking up because of its application in the different field. Okay, and if you will compare it with respect to a particular field, probably Python is lacking there. Okay.
Okay.
So I cannot say specifically which one is good. Both are good in their own terms.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, yeah, for us, Python is good. Why? Because we are data scientists and we are going to do most of the things in this. Okay, so for us, always data scientists, Python will be the best option. You cannot do all these things so easily in Java. Okay, clear guys? So I hope you understood this memory management, how happens internally. Let me know if you have any question in this. If you want me to explain about some complex program, then you can, complex program means any program like for the functional or object oriented, you can let me know. But I hope you guys will practice it on your own on Thorny Editor. Okay, that is more useful tool, one of the most useful tool I have seen if anyone wants to learn Python internally or in depth. Okay, so you guys can practice there. Anyway, so what I was discussing about the integer data type out of the topic discussion we have done. So is it clear that Python doesn't have the data type and why it is so?
Yes, understood.
Okay. Now let's come to the float. Okay. Now floats in Python. So any number with a decimal point. Okay. With the decimal point is called the float value. And here we don't have the double type. And example of that is, let's say 10.20, or you can say -10.20, or you can say 0.0001. This is all the float value. Okay, fine. We don't have the concept of double here. And float cannot be represented in binary, octal or hexadecimal. Clear? Fine, everyone. Now, next we have complex numbers. So, complex number, any number in A plus BJ format is called the complex number, where A is real part and B is imaginary part. Okay, fine. Now what is J? So J is imaginary value. And what is that imaginary value? Imaginary value is square root of -1. You cannot represent this square root of -1 on a number line. That's why we say it is a imaginary value. And any number associated with it called the imaginary part. We have the real part also. So for example, you may have A is equal to 10, B is equal to 20, A is equal to 10 plus 20J, okay? So this is a complex number. If you will check type of A, this will be coming as complex type, okay? Fine. You may have only the imaginary part also. For example, you may write 20J. In that case, the real part will be what? Real part will be the 0. So if you will write B now, it will be giving you 20J. Real part is 0. So if you want to check the real and imaginary part of a complex number, you may write A dot real, that will be giving you the real part, and you may write A dot imaginary, that will be giving you the imaginary part. 10.0, 20.0. Okay. Fine, everyone.
Clear, guys? Any question?
Abhishek, I could not get that real and imaginary part.
Okay. A real part, any number here, this is the real part, which is like, you know, any number without J, that will be the real part, and with the J, that will be the imaginary part. What is this complex number? So complex number finds its use into the mathematical calculations. Okay, we'll be using very rarely this data. Complex data we'll be using very rarely, but there will be very, like, you know, statistical calculation or mathematical calculation. Those who are into the research field, they will be using this kind of this kind of data or this kind of numbers. Okay, we will be mainly restricted to integers and float. Okay.
So when we have given type A, so why only 10 is coming?
Type A 10 is not coming. Type A is coming as class complex.
Okay, class complex.
A dot real is coming 10. A dot imaginary is coming 20.
Okay. So type A is a complex. Yeah, I got it.
So when we give a hexadecimal or octal number, and if we print it shows integer, right? Whereas here it is showing complex itself.
Yes.
Why is it so like that?
Hexadecimal or
Hexadecimal number and print it. It shows an integer type, right? Integer number as the print output value.
Yeah. Every decimal system will have integers, right?
Yeah.
For example, octa also will have integers.
Yes, hexadecimal and octal, they comes under integer.
I mean, every number system will have integers in it.
Yes.
Well, I didn't understood his question. What? So you are saying that if I'm taking a hexadecimal number and if I'm checking a type, it is giving me integer, right?
If we type printf, it shows the integer value, right?
Okay. So you are writing this, right? You are saying that it is coming as the integer integer value, right?
Okay.
Why it is coming here? See, this is the representation. It is not the data type. Complex number is a data type in Python. This is a representation of a integer value.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can write an integer value in these formats. Okay. Whereas this complex itself is a data type. Float itself is a data type in Python. I hope it is clear.
Yeah, clear.
I think if you put some point and something, then I think it will give as a float.
Where?
Yeah. Put a dot and.
No, it will give you the error.
Okay, there are no floating points in hexa.
No. Okay. So you are saying, let's say, if you are writing again FC98 here, like this.
Yeah.
Or let's say, if you will be writing 0x again, it will not be accepted. Okay. Only integer value can be represented in this format. Okay. Yes. You can see integer value means what? See here. Let's say if you are writing A is equal to 10 plus 20J. Okay. So you may write this 10 into the binary format 0B1010 plus 0B10100J. You may write in this format. Okay. If you write print A, this cannot be accepted. You'll be writing with the 20. Sorry. This will be accepted. So you can have the while defining the complex number, you can have the real part as the binary, octal, hexadecimal, anything. And so you cannot take the a float value into the binary, octal, or hexadecimal. Okay, fine. But you can take, let's say, if this is the representation of 10, so it is printing 10 plus 20J, it will convert this binary value or octal value or hexadecimal value automatically into the decimal equivalent.
Okay.
Fine, everyone. So complex, just a number, you can say it is a data type, and there are different ways to represent a number. So like integer value, I can say you can represent an integer value. So what all things I have discussed, let me recap it. So from integer. Okay. So we have started with the integer. We have seen like mainly the data types are what? So we have numerals, integer, float, and complex. The things which I have told you, binary, octal, and hexadecimal, that is the representation of the integer value. So you can represent any integer value into this format. And that integer value may be in the any format. Like you can have that integer value here in the complex number. But you cannot represent, let's say if you are writing 10.20 here. So in this, you cannot write 10 into the binary, octal, and hexadecimal format. No, it is not allowed. Okay, fine. Now, let's say if you are writing here, binary, if you are taking then 0B, small b or capital B, you can take anything. Allowed digits are 0 and 1. And to convert into the binary, we have bin A function. These samples, we have this, right? Octal 0O, allowed digits are 0 to 7. To represent any value into the octal or convert any value into the octal, we can use OCT function. Hexadecimal 0X or capital S, allowed digits 0 to 9 or A to F. Capital or small, anything you can take to convert to hexadecimal values, we have hex function. Okay. We have seen all these examples, and then we have seen there is no concept of size. Why there is no concept of size? Because Python is dynamically typed. We don't have any boundation that we have to specify the data type here, right? So at runtime, it will check that what data you are assigning or how big data you are assigning. Accordingly, the size will be allocated. In other programming languages, what happens in the beginning only, you tell that, let's say if you're writing short A, it means A can have a value which can be stored in maximum 8 bytes of memory. Okay. So for short, 8 bytes of memory is allocated. For int, 16 bytes of memory is allocated. And for long, 32 or 64 bytes of memory is allocated based on your operating system. Okay. But for short, it will be 8, and for int, it will be 16. Long, let's say it is 32 bit of memory. So in that case, you cannot go beyond that range. Okay. So if you are taking the integer, you cannot define a long value inside an integer. Okay. So you are specifying in the beginning itself, whereas in Python it is not the case. You are not specifying the data type. So at runtime it will check that what value you are allocating, and based on that value it will be allocating the memory for your object. Okay, fine. It is not predefined. Okay, now next we have seen the float. So memory management we have seen. So memory management we have seen, it is automatic allocation and deallocation. It is completely automatic in Python. We are nowhere. We cannot not interfere into the memory management of Python. That is completely automatic. Next we have seen float data type. So float data type, any numbers with the decimal point, we have seen it is a float data type and it cannot be represented in any other form, only in the decimal form. Complex value is the number in the format A plus BJ, and where A is real part, B is imaginary part, J is the imaginary value. The value of J is square root of minus one. Okay, we have checked the type, we have checked the real and imaginary part also using the type function and real and imaginary attribute respectively. Clear? So these all are the three different data types. Now let's say if you want to convert anything into the integer, okay, or integer value. So there is the int function. Basically, we are going to learn the type casting. To int, float, or complex. How we will be doing that? Or which all values are accepted here? Okay. So let's say if you want to convert any value to the integer, you will be writing print int of 10. If you are writing, it will be accepting this decimal value. It will be accepting the float value also, 10.20. It will be accepting int of 0b1010. It will be accepting the octal value also. (0, 7, 6, 5, 4). And then it will be accepting the 0xfc98, the hexadecimal value also. What else it will accept? Print int of true. It will be accepting the Boolean value. Print int of, what else it will accept? Float value.
Complex.
Complex one.
No. Yes, it will accept 10 in the quotation. Okay. Now, what all it will not accept? Print int. It will not accept the float value into the quotation. Okay. It will not accept the complex value. Okay, in the quotation, out of the quotation, nothing. It will not accept. Print int of Boolean value in the quotation, 0b1010, it will not be accepting it. Okay, print, it will not accept the, binary value in the quotation, not accept. Now, Boolean value in the quotation will not accept. Okay, and even the string value will also not be accepted. For example, int of a is not accepted. Clear? So, if I will comment this. See, for 10, it is coming as 10. 10.20, it is converting, it is type casting this 10.20 to the float value, it is giving you 10. Next, it is converting this to the decimal value, it is 10. It is converting this octal value to the decimal value, it is 4012. It is converting this hexadecimal value to the decimal value, which is 64,664, true to 1, which is decimal value, and this 10 also to 10. But rest all value will not be accepted. For example, this error. You cannot do that. So if you will read the error, invalid literal for int with base 10, 10.20. Remember that. If you are getting this error, it means you are trying to convert a float value which is kept into the quotation. Okay. Similarly, if you will write this, then you will be getting the type error, can't convert complex to int. So if you are getting this error, it means you are passing the complex value to convert it into the int. If you do this here also, you are going to get you the value error, invalid literal again. Okay. So invalid literal basically, or value error you are getting when the value is not accepted inside the int function, type error in the case of complex. This is also value error. This is also going to be the value error. Okay, fine. So these all values are not accepted inside the int function. I hope this is clear.
So Abhishek, what is the range of int?
Range of int? There is no range of int in Python.
Okay, so it can be infinite, right?
Yeah, you can take any number in the integer, like as integer value.
And including zero.
Including zero.
Yeah, got it.
And Abhishek, while converting float to int, it takes the nearest rounding value, or it's only the upper value it considers? say 10 point, if I put 10.90, will it take only 10 or it will go for 11 or something?
Only 10.
Okay.
Only the float value.
Okay.
Anything else, guys?
Abhishek, there is a print in true. Mm-hmm. For that, the value is 1.
Yes.
So for true, the value is 1?
1, always.
And for false, it is 0?
0, correct.
So how? What is the rule for that?
Rule means there is no rule. True means 1, false means 0. That's it.
Okay. So these are the conditionals, right?
No, these all are the booleans.
Booleans, yeah.
Yeah, outcome of conditional will be a boolean, right?
Yes, correct. Outcome of the conditional will be a boolean.
Yeah, in every language, like mean, we consider 1 as true and 0 as false, basically. Correct.
So basically, from boolean to integer, if you are coming, it means true is always equal to 1, okay? And false is always equal to 0.0, okay?
Okay, fine. So these are the valuations of boolean, right?
Yes. If you are coming from int to boolean, okay, if you are coming from int to boolean, so remember that. Sorry, not 0.0, 0. 0 is false, rest all is true. Okay?
Okay. Yeah.
Fine.
Yes.
So let's say if you have 1, it will be considered as true. If you are having 2, it will be true. If you are having minus 10, that will be true. If you are having minus 100,000 or anything, that will be true. Okay, fine?
Yeah, fine, got it.
But if you will have only 0, that will be considered as
false. Thank you.
Okay. Clear, guys? Any question?
Yes.
Let's see float function accepts, okay? So we have seen for int, now we have to look for the float also. So this int will be replaced with the float function. Guys, you may also type these things and you can check if you are getting the same. Otherwise, we'll keep on listening and we'll keep on forgetting. So better to practice this. In float, only one change. This is accepted. Rest all is not accepted. Okay? Fine. Till here, everything is accepted. So now you are giving this 10 or 20 into the quotation. This is also accepted. If you'll execute it, let me do comment this. Execute it. So 10 is converted to 10.0. 10.20 is to 10.22. 0B1010 is converted to 10.0. 0O7654 is converted to 4012.0. 0XFC98 is converted to 64664.0. 2 is converted to 1.0. 10 is converted in the quotation to 10.0. And 10.20 in the quotation is converted to 10.2. Okay. So these all values are accepted. Which all values are not accepted? These all values are not accepted. Uncommented. Run this code one by one. You will find that type error. Can't convert complex to float. Then this is not accepted. Value error. This is also not accepted, value error. And this is also not accepted, value error. Okay. So these all values are not accepted in the float. Similarly, let's come into the complex function. What all values are accepted into the complex function?
Abhishek, line number 28. So print float, this is a binary one, right? Inside. Yes.
It is not accepted. It is coming in the quotation, no?
Okay.
Now, complex function.
So, in yes. place of float, if that will be inside quotation, if that will be act as a string, then that's a string, right?
Yes, it is. This internal part is a string.
So, in case of float, it will not be evaluated, but in case of integer, it is evaluated, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Why it is so?
Okay. So, see, there are two level of conversion is going to happen here. Remember, two level of conversion will not be allowed. Okay, wherever two level conversion is happening, it is not accepted. Now, what is this two level? What do I mean by this? So, this I should write on the top. So, if you will look at this, Okay. So yes. This is a float value. This float value, if you will remove the quotation, then it is accepted, right?
Yes.
Clear in the case of int. Now here, what you have to do, you have to first remove the quotation, means from string, you have to convert it to the float value, and then float, you have to convert to the int value, right? So two level of conversion is happening, not allowed. Okay. Here also, you have to first remove the quotation, and then you have to, that will get the binary equivalent, and then that binary equivalent has to be converted to the binary integer, not accepted.
Okay.
Same thing here also, true. First quotation has to be removed, because without quotation, true is accepted. With quotation, not accepted, because first quotation has to be removed, means this string value has to be converted to Boolean, and then Boolean to, you can say, the true value. Okay. So this all two level of conversion, wherever it is there, it will be not allowed. Similarly, here also, if you look at this, see, here only one level of conversion is happening, right? You are removing only the quotation. Rest all value is float itself. So it is accepting here. Okay. But when you are coming here, this is two level of conversion, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so it is.
Got it. Yes, Abhishek, got it.
Here, everyone, any other question?
No.
Okay. Now, next we have the complex function.
Can you please repeat that last bit, the one that you said about float?
Okay. So, wherever two level of conversion is there, it will not be, accepted. That value will not be accepted. You can take the example, whichever value you are not accepted, like those which are raising the value error. Okay. You will find that two level of conversion is happening. First, if you remove this quotation, that will be converted into, see, this value you can convert. This value you can convert, or let's say you have here. So this value you can convert. This value you can convert into the integer. How you can convert? So first you convert this into the float. Okay. So one level of conversion is what? From string to float. And then that float is converted to int. This will be accepted. You can see here I are getting 10. So two level of conversion is happening here. Right. So wherever you have two level of conversion, that will not be accepted in the typecasting. Okay. Only one level of conversion.
Okay.
Right. Now complex function. So complex function can be used in two ways. One with the two argument, one with the single argument. So you can pass real and imaginary. This is one way. And the other way is only real part. Okay. In that case, imaginary will be zero. One more thing. In the complex function, when you are passing, if first, so what I was saying, that this complex function can be used in two ways. One with the single argument and one with the two argument. Okay. If you are passing two arguments, so first argument will be taken as the real part. Second argument will be taken as the imaginary part. Because in the complex number, you have two values, right? Real and imaginary. In the complex, if you're passing only one value, it will take it as a real part. And in that case, imaginary will be zero. Okay.
Fine.
And in the complex, if first argument is string, then second value cannot be passed. Remember that. Okay. If you are passing the first value as the string, then second value will not be passed. Correct.
Okay.
This string should also be number. It is not going to be the some character. Okay.
So for example.
Let's see it here. Complex 10. Okay. It is accepted. It will create 10 plus 0 j.
Yes. Okay.
Now we are writing 10. It is accepted. Next we are writing 10.20. This is accepted. Next, we will be writing 10.20, but in the quotation, that will also be accepted. Okay, but you'll see all the imaginary part is zero. Okay, now you may write zero b 1010. This, if you'll be writing 0b1010, so in this case, this will not be accepted. Okay, so this binary representation, or octal representation or hexadecimal representation in the string format will not be accepted. Okay, fine. Now, if you are taking this, this is accepted.
Okay. Now, next, let's say if you are having this first value, okay. Now, the other way to use this is print complex if you are writing. Sorry. You may write true also. 1 plus 0j, what else is left? True, binary is done, octal, hexadecimal, anything you can take. 10 and 10.20, both in the quotation or without quotation you have taken. These all values are accepted, okay? Now, let's say if you are having...
But Abhishek, in all the cases, whatever we are mentioning, always the imaginary part is coming zero. Always.
Yes, why? Because you are not mentioning the imaginary part. No, you are giving only one value. If you are pass only one value, imaginary will be always zero. Here I have written.
Oh, yes. Suppose we give the imaginary part, then...
Yeah, I'll be coming to that. I'm coming to that. So, that is the second. Complex, real and imaginary. Both your parts. 10, 20. Okay. So, this will be coming as 10 plus 20j. Okay.
Okay.
Fine. Now, you can say, you may write here, 0B1010. Here, you may write 0XFC98. Okay. So, this is also giving you 10 plus 64,664j. Okay. Fine, both are accepted. You may also write here true, and here you may write true. Okay, this will be coming as 1 plus 0j, here you may write false. Okay, fine, this will also be accepted. Now, let's say if you have complex of 10, but this is in quotation, you are trying to pass the second value, which is the integer, not accepted. Complex can't take second argument if first is a string. Clear? Fine. Now, you cannot pass the second value as a string. For example, 10, sorry, complex 10, 20. Not accepted. Complex second argument can't be a string. Clear?
No, Abhishek, that 10, 20. Yes, yes. In line number 52, you have mentioned the complex 10-20, and as per the rule, if first argument is string, then second value cannot be passed. But here, the value can be passed. So that is 10 plus 20j. That's why this is happening, right?
No, 1 minute. I'm writing if first argument is string, then second value cannot be passed, right?
Yeah. So if first argument is not string, then second value can be passed.
Yes, second value can be passed.
So 10, 20, you have mentioned 52. So that is coming as a one number, 10 plus 20j.
Yeah, so there are two arguments, no, in this. This is the real part is the one argument, 20 is the another argument, second argument.
Imaginary one.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so by comma, we are separating the imaginary part.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay,
got Abhishek, it. One question here. Yes. Do you want to say that the real and the imaginary both needs to be of the same data type, right?
Real and imaginary both need to be of the same data type, no. Is accepted? The restrictions on the complex function I have already told you. If the first argument is string, you are passing this first argument, which is a string, then second argument will not be passed. Second argument can never be a string. Imaginary part can never be a string. You cannot pass it in the string format. Rest all, everything is accepted.
Okay, Abhishek,
this 10 can be 10.5. In place of 10, we can put 10.5 also, right? Because it is a
yes.
Real.
10.5.
Okay, got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fine, everyone. So basically, why we are learning this int, float, complex? There may be a number of cases where you need to take the input from the user and you have to do the typecasting. So these all are the fundamental data types, and we have these functions for converting any value, like you know, which all values it accept into these data types. Okay. So which value you can convert into this int, float or complex, those list I have given you, you can try all of them and only those values accepted. Apart from that, if you try with other values, probably it will not accept, okay? Because which are accepting, I have given you a list, okay?
Abhishek, one question.
Yes.
The line number,
Okay, 46. 46. There was a in quote 10.20. So only in case of a comma, we are not accepting string as a first number, right?
Not in case of comma. Forget about comma. See, there are this complex function can be used in two ways. You can pass argument means what? You can pass values. Okay. So you can pass one value to this complex function or you can pass two values to the complex function.
Okay.
If you are passing one value, then you can pass anything out of it.
Okay, fine. When you are passing
two values like here, so in that case, those two values should be separated by comma. And if the first value is a string like here, then you cannot pass the second value.
Yes.
It will be giving you the error.
Yeah, yeah, right. Got it. Okay. Got it. Thank you.
Anything else, guys?
So if you are passing only the real value, then it can be string too, right?
Sorry?
If we are only passing real value in the argument, then it can be a string too, right?
It can be a string means no. Like you cannot pass the characters into the string. For example, print complex of, you cannot pass A. It will not be accepted. Okay. String means you can pass an integer value or float value into the string format to the complex function. Okay. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Any question, guys, still here?
Abhishek, so if we want to do with a non-real, the real part is zero and there is only imaginary, we just need to give a blank, comma, and the imaginary?
0, 10.
Okay, we can't able to give it like a space.
No.
In the first parameter, right?
No, you don't pass a space. Like it will not, if it will not, it will not accept a space as a value.
Okay.
Okay, everyone. Any question?
No, Abhishek.
So
Abhishek, one doubt. Suppose if we get 10.20 in quotes in some file, how do we convert to int then? If you need to convert to an integer.
Sorry, to?
10.20, if you are getting it in quotes in some of the files that we get as output from some system, how do we convert it to integer value?
To integer value. The thing you convert that I told you, I showed you. Float. 10.20, then int.
Okay.
So now let's start with this string data type. Strings in Python. So what is a string data type? So first of all, a string we have seen in the literals, like any data or any value which you keep inside the single quotation, double quotation, or triple quotation, that is a string data type in Python. Okay. For example, let's say if you are writing A is equal to this, then if you are printing A, so this is also a string. Or if you are writing thing, the same thing into the double quotation, that is also a string. And if you're writing this same thing into the triple quotation also, that is also a string. Okay. So we have seen this already, that if you keep anything into the single quotation or double quotation or triple quotation made up of single quote or double quote, that is a string data type. If you want, you can check here type of A. That will be coming as a string data type. Clear? Fine. Now, we have seen the use of this single quotation, double quotation, and triple quotation also. For example, let's say, if you are having a string, a quotation as a character in your string, for example, let's say if you're writing A is equal to, this is Python class. Okay, so this is not accepted, right? It will not accept it as a string. It will be giving you the error. For example, if you'll try to print A comma type of A, it will be giving you the error. Okay, now, in this case, what happens? So you cannot keep, like, you know, you want this apostrophe to be considered as a character, not as a quotation, right? Whereas Python, what Python is understanding, that your string is starting here and ending here. So you are not defining this properly. It is giving you the error. Okay. So you have to keep this string into the double quotation now. So if you'll keep this string into the double quotation, this string will be accepted. Okay, now you can see this single quotation is coming as a character for this string. Similarly, let's say if you have the single quotation as the character or the double quotation as the character in your string, for example, this is the double quotation as the character, it will not be accepted. Again, the same error you are getting here. Your string is starting here, ending here. This thing is starting here, ending here. What about this part? So it is not properly defined. It is giving you the error. Okay, so now you have to keep this string into the single quotation. Now, if you will execute it, so this will again be coming as a character, right? But what if you have the both the quotation, single and double quotation, both into the string? For example, let's say this you have, this is Python and Java class. So this thing has single quotation also as the character, double quotation as also as the character. So this thing cannot be either be kept into the single quotation or double quotation. So this can be kept it in into the triple quotation. So I'm keeping it into the triple quotation. Now if you'll print A comma type of A, so it will be giving you as a string data type.
Abhishek, why we are writing print A comma type A? We can directly write string type A.
Yes, type A, we are printing this string also. That's why we are writing A comma type A.
A gives the value of what is there in A, and type of A gives what is the data type of A.
Yeah, got it.
Yeah. We are printing two values. Okay.
Yeah, Abhishek, I have one question basically. Basically, if you do a mistake in line number 18, so do some mistake, please.
Okay.
So can you execute this? So nothing is coming, right? In the sense, line number 10 and line number 14, they are also not getting executed.
Yes, yes. Because it is a syntax error.
Acha. First, it will check the syntax of everything, line in the file, and then it will start executing. Is that correct?
Yes. Compile time error. I have discussed that compile time error. It checks all the, like, you know, when you execute the code, so first it compiles the code. So in the compilation stage, it checks that what all syntax error or indentation error you have. If you don't have any syntax error or indentation error, then only code will start executing.
Yeah, got it. Thanks.
Okay, yeah. Clear, everyone? So this is the use of single quotation, double quotation, triple quotation. There is one more use of single quotation, double quotation, and triple quotation is to declare multi-line string, we use triple quotation. Okay. For example, let's say if you have A is equal to, this is Python class. So if you are writing this thing into the single line, it will be executed. It will be giving you the output. But if you are writing this thing into the multiple lines, then it will be giving you the error. It is not accepted. You cannot write a string into the multiple line using single quotation. Rather, you can use double quotation to you know, write this thing. So for example, you can write it into the you can use triple quotation. You cannot use single quotation or double quotation, but yes, you can use triple quotation. Now if you'll be writing the this string into the triple quotation, it will be accepted as the string, and now it is printing as it is. Okay, fine everyone. So these are the different uses of the single quotation, double quotation, and triple quotation, and you can define this string using them. Okay.
Abhishek, we can do one thing. We are doing double quotation three times, like triple time. So we can use single quotation, triple time, and the result will come.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes. Yes.
So the thing is,
triple quotation made up of single quote or double quote. Triple quotation made up of. Yeah, doesn't matter.
Okay. Got it.
Both will be the same. Both are used for the same purpose. Okay.
Yeah. Got it.
Okay. Now, next, let's say if we have so we have discussed what is a string. Now let's see discuss the properties of this string. Okay. Now, so first one we have is a string is a sequence. Okay. When you say string is a sequence, so string follows indexing and slicing. Okay, fine. And then string follows both positive indexing and negative indexing. Okay, now positive indexing starts from zero from left side, and negative indexing starts from minus one from right side. Okay, fine, clear. Now indexing, slicing. String is an ordered collection of elements. Okay, fine. The basic operation which we can perform on this string are indexing, we have discussed. Slicing, I have told you these two operations. Apart from that, concatenation, repetition, membership operation, and identity operation. Okay, these all are the different operations which you can perform on this string. So these all are the different properties of this string. Now let's discuss them one by one. First of all, indexing. Now, what is indexing? Indexing is accessing one element at a time. Okay. Now, to do the indexing, we follow square bracket notation. Okay. And as we have discussed that positive indexing starts from zero and negative indexing starts from minus one, from left and right hand side respectively. So let's see how this positive and negative indexing occurs. So for example, let's say if you have S is equal to Python. Okay. So this will be represented like this. P So from the left hand side, it will be starting from zero. So this is at zero index. This is at one index. Two. Five. And here minus six. Minus five. Minus four. Minus three. Minus two. Minus one. Okay, so if you are coming from left to right, then it is a negative indexing, or you can say this is the negative indexing from right to left, okay, minus one is star from minus one. And if you are coming from if you are going into this direction, then it is negative indexing. And if you are coming from left to right, then it will be the positive indexing. Okay, fine, clear everyone? Now see, I have represented this Python here, and since I wanted to show this indexing proper, so I've given this space. There is no space between the characters, okay? And even space is also considered as a character inside this string, okay? So if you have Python space class, so accordingly here one space with, let's say this is after three spaces, there is another space, and then one more three spaces after this C, then three spaces after that L, then three spaces after that A, then three spaces after that F and S. Okay, now this is the space, so this five, and after that this will become six. This space character will become six. So this will be considered as the, so this will become six. Okay, so this will be considered as the space character, will also be considered as the space, as the character. And why I'm showing this spaces, because this spaces, I just wanted to separate these numbers. I want them to be visible properly. That's why I've written this. Okay, fine.
So Abhishek, how many characters will be inside? Because here we have 12 characters. So from right hand side, we can start minus one till 12.
Yes, minus 1 till minus 12.
Okay. So these and numbers are not limited till 1 to 6. It depends upon the number of character, right?
Yeah, it can. Yes, it depends on the number of character inside a string.
Yeah, got it.
Okay. So now, there is a len function which gives you the length of this string. Okay. So we have len function. We may write len of s. If you will be writing, it will be giving total number of character inside this string, which is giving you 12. Okay, so remember that whatever the number of character, so if you want to find the index of last character, you can say positive index of the last character. Okay, positive index of the last character will be length of the string minus 1. Okay. And negative index of the last character will be what? Negative index of the last character. Negative index of the first character will be minus of length of S. Minus of length of S.
Yes.
Yes, negative indexing, what is the application of it? Where is it used?
Actually, it is the feature of Python. Useful in many cases. For example, let's say if you want to access the last character, or if you want to do any operation or based on the last character, you know that by default that element will be at minus one index. Okay, this is the feature of Python. What is the use of positive indexing then? To access the element. Negative indexing also used to access the element. Okay.
I think it will be used while traversing.
Traversing, or there are many uses, as I said. So let's say if you have any operation app, there is a problem. Let's say you have a list of tuples where you have to sort that tuple based on the last element in that tuple. So you know that last element will always be one. Now you can have a tuple of two value also, three values also, four values also. If you will have, let's say, okay, so I have 1, 2, then 3, 1, 1, then 5, 4, and then we'll be have 4, 5, 6, 3, 1. Okay, I want you to sort this element, sort this list. Okay, so the output will be what? Not one. This will be, let's say, three. So I want you to sort this. So while sorting it, how I want you to sort it? I want you to sort it based on the last element of this tuple. Okay, this is the tuple internally based on the last element. So last element is what? This one. Next, this is two. Next, this is three, and this is four. So if you'll be sorting in that order, so the length of the tuple inside this list is not fixed. No, you cannot say that I'll be sorting based on one index, right? Because one index is here, one. I don't want you to sort based on one. I want you to sort based on this index, right?
Yes.
Here also I want to sort you based on this index. Here I want you to sort based on this index, right? So in that case, you can do this sorting easily by saying that I want to sort this by using minus one.
Okay.
Okay. Clear, everyone?
Abhishek, I have a question. Suppose I want to extract only the decimal part of, say, a float number. Is there a function, or should I be using indexing to do that?
No, there indexing can only be done on the sequences. String is a sequence. Okay. You cannot access only the float part. If you want to access the float part, then what you need to do, you have to write, let's say, print 10.20, and
Okay, great. Thank you.
But that will be again string. You can convert it to the
Okay.
Okay. This way you can do that. Okay. Clear, everyone? This one is clear. What is the index of the last character? Length of string minus one. Positive index of the last character is what? Length of the string. What is the length here? 6 character, right? So yes. 6 minus one is the 5. Okay. What is the index of the first character? It is the minus of the length of the string, minus 6. Clear? Okay, fine. So now,
yes, clear.
Element, okay. So I'll be writing S of 0. First element, how I can access S of 0? Clear? Or we may also write S of minus of length of string. Can I say that? Correct? Okay, so we can access this way, or we can also write print S of minus 6, right? All these things are possible. Accessing last character, which, what I can say, so S of minus 1 I can say, or minus of length of S, minus 1, length of S minus 1 I can say, or I can say S of length of S, sorry, this one I have already here, minus 5, I think, yes. Okay, all these things are possible.
But Abhishek, S of the letter we can write, like S of 0, you have mentioned print S of 0. So that will be...
First character is at 0 index?
Yes.
Or I can say minus of length of the string.
Yes.
Or I can say minus 6 also.
It's minus 6. That will be 0. That will be P.
That will be P. Correct. That will be P.
Then S0 will be also P.
Yes, S0 will also be P.
Yeah. Got it.
All this. These are the three different ways you can access. So either you can access using the positive index or the negative index. Or you can use this length based indexing. So if you know the length, and then if you know that at which position exactly the character you want to access, accordingly you can do that. Okay. Now, if you want to access the character at a particular index, you may write S of, let's say, for you want to access the character at 3 index. So you may write 3, and it will be giving you the element at 3 index, which is H. Okay. So these all are the indexing. this is it. Now let's come to the slicing. Any question in the indexing?
Abhishek, where we are specifying that we are going in positive indexing or negative indexing, is there any example of that? Like we can write somewhere in comment that we are going towards positive index or negative index.
How? See, it is visible here, no? It is positive indexing. I'm not using minus, it is positive. These two are negative. This is a positive and this is also positive. This is negative.
So we are using length of S. Suppose we are like we want to specify Python like any character. What will be the position of that character in terms of positive indexing or negative indexing? That also we can specify somewhere. No, suppose we are finding a position of a character. So
No. 1 minute. Your question is you want to find the index of a character, right?
Yes.
Okay. Different operation, we'll be learning that. As of now, what we are doing, we are accessing the character based on the index, okay?
Yes.
Indexing means accessing the character based on the index. If you want to know the index of a character, that is the different operation. We'll be learning about it later.
Okay. So here we are learning the length of it, the length of the character.
No, length of the string. We are one minute. We are learning indexing here, one thing, and different ways of indexing.
Got it. Yeah.
Okay. So let's say if you want to access the first element, then what are possible ways you can access the first element? Either you may write S of 0, that will give you the first element here. Correct, P? Or you may write S of minus of length of S. Minus of length of S is what? Length of S is what? 6, right? Total element, how many elements you have? 6 elements, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And minus of length of S will give you the first element. Count the letters, count it, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6. So first character is at minus 6. These all three ways you can access the first character, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Fine. Now this one, this is the last character. So how you can access the last character? This is the last character.
Abhishek, one question. Can we perform this operation of accessing first character on this string, like 1, 2, that one?
No. That is the, that you do in the arrays.
Yeah,
arrays.
That one.
Yeah, that you do in the array, not in the string.
Okay. Yeah, Abhishek, I understood the whole concept. Yeah.
Okay. So indexing is what? Accessing the element from the string. Okay. As of now, if you want to access one element, you can do indexing. You cannot access two elements. For example, I cannot give you YTH using indexing. For that, we have slicing. Slicing is what? Accessing multiple elements at a time. Okay. For example, let's say if you have this string print S of, you want to access T and H, then what you should do? So the syntax of slicing, first let's understand the syntax is, that first you need to write my_str, then you need to write start colon stop colon step. Okay, these three values. Okay, start, stop and step. Fine. Now, what is the start? So start will always be, default value of start is 0. Default value of stop is length of the string. And step value, default step value is always +1. Okay, fine. Now, you can slice the string either in the forward direction or in the backward direction. Let's say if you have S is equal to, this is Python class, okay? This is the Python class. So this is the string you have. Now, let's say if I want to slice only Python out of it, how can I do that? So I can mention start, stop, and step. Accordingly, I will be able to access it. Okay. Now, let's say step value. Step value has to be discussed. Step value can be positive. If it is positive, it means slicing will be done from left to right. Okay, and step is negative, then slicing will be done from right to left. Okay, fine. So now let's understand this, what it is. So let's say if you are writing print s of, you are not mentioning anything in the start, stop and step. Okay, so here you have to keep start, here you have to keep stop, here you have to keep step. You have not mentioned anything in the start, stop and step. Then what is the default value of start? It is zero. What is the default value of stop? It is length of the string. And what is the default value of step? It is one. So basically it will be giving you the whole string. It means you have to start slicing from this location, then you have to go till the end. So start is zero, stop is the till length of this string, and then you have to slice every character. That means step is equal to one. If you will execute it, you are getting the whole string as it is. Clear? Fine, everyone. You are getting the whole string. Clear? Now, same thing you can observe here. If I'm writing S of, I'm starting from zero, then I'm going till the length of the string. Okay? I'm going till the length of the string and I'm taking every character. So step is one. Now, if I will execute it, so I'll be getting
length minus one, right? Length minus one.
No, Vishak, actually you have to write S instead of str.
Correct, S, yes. Okay, so I'm getting the whole string. Clear? So have I said that, see, here also, in this also, you are getting the same output. In this also, you are getting the same output. So can I say that default value of start is zero, default value of stop is length of string, and default value of step is one? Can I say that?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Now, let's say if we have, if I want to slice only Python out of it, okay, what I should do? So I want to slice Python S off. I want to start from where? I want to start from P. What is the index of P? Can anyone tell me what is the index of P?
9.
8.
Okay. What is the, I want to slice till N. What is the index of N?
13.
And I want to take every character. So what I should mention? One.
One.
If I will execute it, I'm getting P, Y, T. T-H-O. I'm not getting
nine.
So remember, this stop value will always be one index extra than the value or than the index till where you want to slice. You wanted to slice till N, right? So get the index of N and add one into that. So index of N was 13. You have to add one into that. Now okay. If you will write 14
okay, here. Vishak, I have one question. What if the sentence ended at Python only, there is nothing beyond Python, beyond N, then what you would have given?
I will come to that. Wait a minute. Okay. So let me finish that. So okay. I hope this is clear, right? So if you want to slice till N, okay, then in that case, you can give, you have to get the index of N and then you have to add one into it. Okay. So that will be giving you the expected object. Clear? Fine, everyone?
Yes.
Okay, now, so let's say if I want to slice this is, what I should give, can anyone tell me what is the index I should write here?
Six. Start from six. Yeah, then eight.
Six, eight, one. What is the index of I? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Index of I is 5. So I should give 5 here, right? I want to start from 5. Now 5, 6, and 7. So this should be 7, right? So this should be 7. Yeah. Now 1. So is it mandatory to write this 1? Because by default it is taking 1. No. So why it is required to write no? You just write without that. It will be taking is. Clear?
So Abhishek, why this position will be 7? We are adding plus 1 into that.
No, he is considering the space.
It will be slicing till... No, it is not considering the space. Here, you can see it is not considering the space. There is no space after S. Okay.
So why this is 7 then? Because S number is 6.
Yeah, I told you that till where you want to slice, you want to slice till S, right?
Yes.
Okay. So get the index of S and add 1 into that. Why we are doing that? Because see, this stop value is not inclusive. This is exclusive. Means it will slice till stop minus 1. Whatever value you will give here, it will slice till this value minus 1. Understood? Means it will slice till 6. Means in the output, you will give getting till 6 only, not 7. 7 will not be included.
Sorry, okay. I didn't get it. Like, why we are adding plus 1?
Plus 1 is stop, whatever you will mention here in this stop value.
Okay.
That value is not inclusive. It means it will not slice till this value. It will slice till the given value of stop minus 1.
Stop minus 1?
Yes.
But we are doing it stop plus 1. Stop is okay. S and S is 6.
Yes. So that's what. So that's what you are adding 1, right?
Yes.
Correct? So now you have given 7, right? So you wanted to slice till S. What is the index of S?
7. Sorry, 6.
6. 6. You are adding 1 so that it can slice till 6.
Sorry, S is 7.
S is 6.
And we are adding 1.
1, so that it can slice till 6.
So, is this the rule that we have to add 1?
Yes, you have to do that. If you want, till wherever you want to slice, you have to get the index of that character and then you have to give 1 more index in the stop value only in this stop value.
Yeah.
Okay. You have to remember that. You have to, that is the kind of concept, or you can say you have to memorize it.
Okay. Yeah, got it.
Okay.
And that step value is always 1.
If you are not mentioning, it is 1. Default value is 1.
And if suppose we want to use step in slicing, step is something else, right?
Yeah, you can mention some other value also, that we will be coming to step value later.
Okay.
As of now, start and stop is clear?
Yes.
So start will be from where you want to slice, that exact index you will provide. Stop will be till where you want to go, that index plus 1 you will provide. Okay?
Yeah, got it.
Clear, everyone? Okay.
Yeah.
Now, let's say if I want to slice this class, then what I should write?
Till where, Abhishek?
Class, this last word.
Class 16?
15. Length of
17.
15. Can we go by minus 7, negative? 15.
17.
15. Colon?
23.
17 colon 23.
17. Where is 17? This was 13. This is 14. This is 15, no?
Yeah, 15.
15. 15. Now, 20. What is this stop value?
20.
It can give a length of S.
20.
15, 16,
20.
17,
18, 19. 20. So, 19 20. Is the last index. I should provide 20 here, right?
20.
Yeah. Colon 1. Okay. Now, this will be giving me class. Clear?
Yes.
Fine. Clear, everyone? Rajdeep, is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. You may skip this one also. You may not write it here. Why? Because your string is ending, right? Your string is ending in this word. So if you will not give by default, it will go till end. You can see it is giving class. Why? I told you, if you are not mentioning stop, by default, the stop value will be what? Length of the string. And what is the length of the string? It is 20. Isn't it? Length of this string is 20 or not? Tell me. You guys told me the index of S is 19, right? So length of this string will be plus 120, isn't it? So by default, it will be taken 20 here.
So you are considering the full length.
Yeah, we are considering the full length. Means we are going till the end.
till the end.
Starting from 15 till the end. Okay.
Okay.
Can you put 12 instead of 15?
If I'll put 12 instead of 15, then it will start slicing from 12 till the end.
Okay. Yeah. Got it.
So Abhishek, how we are going, like the last string, so we are not writing, not mentioning the number. So the same way, if we want to write this THIS, so first start, we don't have to write.
Yes, correct. Exactly. So means let's say if you want to, right? If you, let's say if she says that if we want to print this, okay, so we may write S of. We don't need to mention start value here because by default we are starting from zero, right? We have to give only this stop value.
Okay.
So 0, 1, 2, 3. C is the index of S. We can give here 4. This will give you this. Okay.
Okay, got it. Can we try negative indexing in this or this is not possible?
Yes, I'll come. I'll come to that. So as of now, it is clear, right? Everyone?
Yes.
Is it clear? Still here? Okay.
Yes.
Now let's see how we can perform this slicing using the negative indexing. So S of, let's say, if I want to slice this Python, okay? I want to slice this Python. Then tell me what will be the start index, stop index, but you have to provide it into the negative indexing. Tell me what is the start index?
That will be -1.
I want to
-7.
-12. I want to slice Python. I told minus Python means I want to slice from P. So I have to get the negative index of P. What is that? -1, -4, -5, -6, -7, -8, -9, -10, -11, -12. Correct. So this is -12. Okay. Now I want to slice till N. Right. So what index I should give as this top?
-6.
-7. -5. -6. -7.
Okay. I want to slice till N, right? So I have to give the index of this space, isn't it? So that I can slice till N. So get the index of this space. -1, -2, -3, -4, -5, -6. Okay.
Execute it. Right to left now.
Yes, we are coming from right to left.
So in every case, we have to add +1 in case of stop.
Here you are not adding +1. Actually, see, in more technical ways, I should say that you should give the index of the character till where you want to slice, of the next character till where you want to slice.
Yeah, till next character. Yes.
Yes.
That means +1.
Yes. Okay, so you want to slice till N, you have to give the index of the next character. Okay, don't use +1, -1 because that is quite confusing. Okay, so next character, simple.
Yeah, till next character. Yes.
Okay, anything else, guys?
Yeah, I got it, Abhishek.
Okay, so now let's see this. Tell me what will happen in this. Everyone is clear on this, right?
Yes,
Abhishek.
If I'll be writing colon -1, then what it will do?
It will print all the string.
It will be in the reverse.
All the string.
In the reverse.
Correct. In the reverse order. I'll be coming to that. But one thing I need to make a note here, that if you are using step is equal to step is a positive value. Okay. If step is a positive value, then start should always on left side compared to stop value. Can I make a outcome here from all these examples? Take this. Step is positive. Start is on the left of stop. Start is on the left of stop. Start is on the left of stop. Here also start is on the left of stop. Here also start is on the left of stop. And in this case also start is on the left of stop, right? This is the start and stop on the right-hand side, isn't it? Can I say that?
Yes.
Fine. Now, just the opposite, if this step is negative. If step is negative, then your start will always be on the right-hand side compared to your stop value. Okay. For example, let's say if you are writing s colon colon minus one. So if you will execute it, it is going to give you the whole thing into the reverse order. Okay. Now what can I say that? So let's see. If I'll be writing s of, I want to slice. So start means if it is slicing from s, it means this is the start index, right? Okay, colon. I want to go till the end, right? So I'll be writing here minus of
minus
length of the string minus one, okay? And colon minus one. Can I say it now that your start index is on the right hand side compared to your stop index?
Yes,
okay. So
yes.
If you will execute it here also, you are getting the same thing. Now, one observation we should also make here that if your step value is minus one, then default start is what? Minus one. And default stop is what? Minus of length of string minus one. Clear? Can I say that?
Yes.
From makes these sense. Two examples, can I say?
Yes.
Okay. Fine. Okay. Now, the next thing I'll be coming, let's say, if I want to slice Python into the reverse order, what I should write? Tell me. Now it's your call. Give me the output. Python in the reverse order. Start, stop, and step value.
Minus 7, minus 13.
Okay, so minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, minus 7, correct? So start is minus 7, and your stop is what? Minus 13. Minus 7, minus 8, minus 9, minus 10, minus 7, minus 12. Minus 13, because minus 13. We want to slice till P, right? So we have to give the index of the next character. So this will be minus 13.
In minus 1.
Comma, minus 1. This is in the reverse order. Okay? Fine? Clear, everyone?
Yeah, clear.
Okay. So this is done. Now, step value can also be, step can be plus or minus one. It can be plus or minus two. It can be plus or minus three, etc.
Okay. I have a kind of doubt. Like in the line number 102, you have mentioned negative. Then start should always on right side compared to stop value.
Yes.
So if we are starting from Python, we are starting from N. So it is not give. It is not giving us the result Python. It is giving the reverse.
It is giving. No. We don't want Python. We want Python in the reverse order.
Oh, we want Python in reverse order.
Okay. Abhishek, can you repeat this negative slicing?
This one?
Yes.
This one. Okay. So negative slicing. Negative slicing means generally we negative slicing means what I have told you in the beginning. This negative slicing means slicing will be done from right to left, okay? So when you are giving the positive step value, okay, if you are giving the positive step value, slicing, all the slicing we have done into this direction, isn't it? You remember? We have done this, we have done is, we have done Python, we have done class, we have done this is Python class, everything from left to right, isn't it?
Right.
Correct?
Yeah.
But if you will mention step as negative value, then the slicing will be done from right to left. Okay. It means it will be done in the reverse order. Okay. So when you are doing it in the reverse order, so let's say if you want to slice this Python into the reverse order, then your start position is what? Index of N. Your stop position is what? Index of P. That is what you have to mention here.
Yeah, right. Got it.
Okay. Clear, everyone? Any other question?
Yeah, clear, Abhishek.
Your step value can also be plus or minus one, plus or minus two, plus or minus three, and so on. It can be any value. Okay. Now, in that case, what will happen? Let's say if you are writing print s of colon colon two. I am writing plus two. Then in that case, what will happen? See, I have not mentioned start. By default, it will start from zero. I have not mentioned stop. By default, it will go till length of the string. Okay. And I have mentioned two. So because of this step value 2, it will take every second value. So it is starting from T, the second value is I. After this I, the second value is space. After this space, the second value is S, and so on. So if you will execute it, it will be taking every second value. Clear, everyone?
Yeah. Yeah, Abhishek, if we are not giving anything in stop, then it is taking whole character length. And
yes, full string length. Full string length.
And suppose we are like we want to type a bunch of character from those strings. So that time stop value is increasing by next character.
Yeah. So whatever you, if you'll mention two, it will take every second character. If you'll mention three, it will take every third character. For example, if I'll mention three, it will take every third character out of S. For example, let's print S here first, and then let's see. So if you are writing three, it is taking every third character. First character is T, then the third character is S. So you can see T and then S. After this S, the third character is what? 1, 2, and 3 character is S. Again, it is printing S. After this S, what is the third character? 1, 2, and 3, Y. So Y is, it is printing, and so on.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, got it. So in this in this step, using a step like +-1, +-2, +-3, so here we are not giving any start or stop value. Only we are giving the step.
Yes, you, if you can give the start and stop value also, you can, let's say if I want to slice only this Python, okay, so you'll be giving here 8:13 or 8:14, whatever, and it will slice, so it will slice only into this interval and it will take only three values, means every third value, okay? So only P and H. So if you look at this output, P, after the third, after that, the third value is what? 1, 2, 3. H is the third value. After this, the third value, you don't have any other value after this, okay?
Okay. Yeah.
Anything else, guys? Anything else? Okay. So you can use minus values also in this step. I'll be coming to your question. Someone has asked me the question in the group, sorry, in the chat. Maliha, I'll be coming to your question.
Abhishek, I guess in the line 105, you need to mention step equal to -1. Just for.
105, step is equal to -1. Thank you. So we have, let's say you can write :: -2 also. Okay. In this case, what it will be do? It will be doing this slicing in the reverse order. If you'll execute it, reverse order, but every second character. Clear? Fine, everyone. Reverse order, but every second character.
Yes, sir.
Similarly, you can write -3. So you can write -3 will give you the reverse order every third character, and so on. Okay. So this is the output. This is the slicing. Now someone asked me, what is the use of the slicing? See, this is the use of the slicing. Someone asked me that I want only the decimal, you know, the value after the decimal. I have done that using slicing only. Tell me what we are doing. Can anyone tell me? So this method, b.index method, gives you the index of this character. Okay. Fine. So I'm getting the index of this dot. What is the index of this dot? 0, 1, 2. It is the 2. So 2: I'm doing. b of 2: What is the b of 2? So b is this number in the string. 2: is what? So starting from this dot, right? So starting from dot till the end, it is slicing. Okay, and then we are converting it into the float value.
So what do you mean by dot? Like index dot, I understood. That will be position 2 and is 2:1. And what about B dot?
B dot, this is the, you are trying to find the index of this dot on this string, B string. Okay?
On B string, yeah.
So the why it is coming 0.2 basically.
He converted it.
Why
into
because
float.
Why because when you write here print float. You know, so it is a float value that will be converted by default into 10.2. Okay, so yeah. If you want to keep the keep this zero, then you have to do this thing formatting that we will be learning again later. Okay,
right.
That everything is possible. Whatever you want to do, everything is possible. You can get. Basically, this is one use. Another use, let's see. See here. You have a list, okay? correct? This is the four email ID. What I want only the username. Okay? I want only the usernames. I don't want the domains. Like I don't want @gmail.com or I don't want @yahoo.com or @hotmail.com. I want to skip that. How can I do that? So I can do that this way. For I in LSC, correct? I, here I'll be writing starting from the beginning, right? So you want your, always your username will be in the beginning. So you are starting from the beginning and you want to slice still @, right? So you'll be writing I dot index of @. Okay, execute this, you'll be getting all the username. Used in data analysis a lot. Clear?
So here we don't have those complications, right? To search for that @ and then extract.
We don't
those
have.
Things are, we don't have those complications, right? Searching for that specific keyword like @ and then extracting the part before. These things are not here. Directly we can get.
Actually, we are doing that same thing. We are extracting first the index of @
mm-hmm.
using this part. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then we are slicing it. Just we are slicing it and then we are keeping it inside the list using loop comprehension.
Okay. Okay. So you are keeping it back into the list.
Yes. Yes. We are keeping back into the list.
Okay. Okay.
Abhishek, is this a lambda expression?
Sorry, Madhu, your voice is not audible. Can you please come again?
Sorry, is this a lambda expression?
No, it is not a lambda expression. It is called the list comprehension, or you can say the loop comprehension. And basically, the technical one is comprehension, we can say. Okay, we'll be learning that in the list. Is it clear, guys? Any question?
Abhishek, in the statement of
yes?
Print float, print in bracket float, b dot mm-hmm. index in that line, why we are using mm-hmm. Index dot input dot, then again that two dots which we use for slicing.
We are using the slicing operation. Why we are using the slicing? Because the question was I want to slice this part.
Okay, so yeah? That dots so, are dot will be considered till end, right? Last index.
Yeah, by default it will go till the end.
Okay.
Got it. And this one I am using to get the index of this dot inside this string format of 10.20.
Yeah, got it. Understood. Thank you.
Clear, everyone? Any question?
This, can you explain this for loop for I equal to for I in list?
This way it will be written like this. So see. OUT underscore LST is equal to, this is an output list, and then you'll be writing for I in LST, you will be taking this I element and then you are going to slice the index. So you'll be getting the index is equal to I dot index of @, basically you are getting the index, right? So you'll be passing this to the OUT underscore LST dot append.
This case, what is I in this particular case? I in list.
I index I, are... I is picking one element from this list.
Achha.
At a time.
Okay.
So now you'll be doing I of IND colon. Sorry. Colon IND.
Okay. This is list of strings basically.
Okay.
And
now
I...
you can print output list.
Okay.
Okay, same thing you are getting, but you are getting in the multiple lines. Here you are getting into the single line.
Okay.
Clear? Anything else? Any other question, guys? Yeah, up to here, still indexing, slicing. Forget about this. This is just the one use case I have shown you. So this one I will cover later.
Abhishek, I have.
What is dot append?
Dot append is the list function. We'll be learning it in the list. Yes.
That 6 number line. How do you write that line? Like I then bracket.
That I will discuss in the list. The lot of background is there behind that. So still we are into the beginning stage. We'll be coming to that part in the list and in the loop, okay?
Yeah, like how to write a line. Like here, I'm a little bit confused. I don't.
No, ignore that line. That's what I'm saying. Ignore that line as of now. I have just same method I'm going to discuss today. So first, let me discuss few things, and then we'll be coming. So this is the later part. No, this is coming after loop, and then once list will be covered, then after that it will be coming. Okay. So as of now, we are into the beginning stage. So just keep it on hold for some time. In upcoming class, you'll be learning that part also. Okay.
So like Abhishek, like how to write a complex line. So it's a complex line for me because I'm a non-programmer.
I understand. That's not complex. That is very simple. This is one of the simplest line I have written in the list comprehension. And I am giving you the guarantee that you will learn it, but not now. Give me some time. I cannot explain it right now. See, what is happening here? So let's see. There is a thing. So these all things you are still yet to learn. So let's say you have this S is equal to this is this string. Okay. Now I want to get the index of at the rate. So what I can do, I will be writing IND is equal to S dot index of at the rate. Okay. So if I'll print IND, it will be giving me the index of this at the rate. It is 3. Count it 0, 1, 2, 3, right?
Yes.
Clear? Fine. So I've got the index of 3. Now what I want out of this? So I want to slice only ABC. What I'll be writing? Will I be writing S of colon 3? Will it give me ABC? Clear?
Yes.
Fine. Now I'm performing this operation on a loop. Simple.
Yeah. And in second line, we are writing int is equal to S dot index. So why we are writing S dot index?
To get the index of at the rate. You asked me the question. I think you only asked me the question that what if I want to get the index of a character in a string?
Yes.
You can access the character using the index. But what if you want to access the index of a character, then what will happen? How you will do that? So that you can do using index method.
Okay. So that's why we have to write S dot index.
Understood?
So Abhishek, that's why we
not s dot index, like yes dot index, this s will be the name, s will be the any string name.
Yeah, to find the integer value where that at the rate is lying, to get that we need to use index function on that string.
Index method, to get the index value we will be using the index method.
Yeah, integer location of that particular character.
Yes, correct. You can say integer location.
On line 4, it should be S square brackets colon IND, right? Basically, that's why.
Exactly. So if you are using IND, so you should write this, execute this same thing. Okay.
Okay. And Abhishek, how we can say in programming language, we are writing S dot index at the rate. That means, S is the string, so the at the rate index, mm-hmm. the space of or the location
no,
of
no. I'll tell you what does it mean. What does it mean is I want to find the index of at the rate character into the string S,
inside the string S.
Hello.
S.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Your is equal to is an assignment operator.
Sorry. Can you please repeat the question? Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, like you were explaining that one. Like I was saying the of the string, right? Like
yes, of the string, yes, correct.
Of the string. So of the string means we are writing S dot.
You have
yes, S dot.
Inside the string you are finding the rate, right? That's why S dot index.
Yes, correct. Hema, if you want to find any character inside this string, then you'll be writing that string dot index method.
Yeah, dot index is the method, but S we are writing to define that it is inside S.
Correct. It is inside S. In that string, I want to find. That's why I'm writing S.
Yeah. For it.
Okay.
For example, if there are two at the rate symbols in same string, so till the first one it gives?
It will always give you the first one.
Oh, okay.
Okay, it will always give you the index of first one. But if you want to find the index of both ones, that is the assignment. We'll be giving you the assignment, okay?
And one more question, Abhishek. Like, I understood s dot index at the rate, but before that, we are writing int equal to s dot index. So what does that mean, int equal to?
Okay, so this is going to return a value, the index value, right? What is the index value? It is 3, right? That 3 value we are storing into this variable ind.
Actually, is equal to symbol here is an assignment operator, basically. Exactly. And whatever is there on the right hand side, the value returned by the right hand side will be assigned to the one that is there in the left hand side.
Correct. So that is the operator, assignment operator. Hema, let's see here. So there is one operator called assignment operator. Okay. Now what happens in the assignment operator? Let's say if you have a value 10, if you want to assign this value to a variable, you write a is equal to 10, right? It means this 10 will be assigned to this variable a, right? Correct.
Yes.
So similarly, this ind to this ind name, you are assigning the result of this operation. What is the result of this operation? It is 3, isn't it? So that value you are assigning to the ind name or ind variable.
Yeah.
Clear?
So here we are doing print A, so that's why we are doing print IND.
Yes, exactly. We are printing the value of index. So if you'll be writing print IND, it will be giving you 3. Here if you'll be writing print A, it will be giving you the value associated with A.
Value of A. So we are specifying that this is an index function, like index variable result we are giving.
Yes, so we are, so this, when we are printing IND, it is telling that the index of at the rate is 3. That's what we are getting from you. Okay.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. Got it, yes, Karim.
How to find out the negative
Karim,
index?
Go ahead.
Negative index number, how to find out?
Negative index, you cannot find. The way to find the negative index, you got the positive index, right? So,
can we find full length? Full length minus.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. So, let's say if you will be writing, this will be minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, minus 7, minus 8, minus 9, minus 10. So, minus 11, minus 12, minus 13. Minus 13, minus 3, minus 10. Yeah, I think you can do this way. Print minus of length of the string, length of the string, and plus IND. That will be giving minus 10. Minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, minus 7, minus 8, minus 9, minus 10. Correct. Now you get the index of anything. Let's say if you'll be getting the index of G. What is that? It is 4, right? So minus 13 plus 4, it will be minus 9. It is minus 9. You can get the index. So basically, you have to get the index and then you have to do minus of length of this thing plus that index. Okay, this will be giving you the negative indexing. I hope it is clear. Yes.
Yes.
Directly it will not come, I think. Okay. So is there a tokenizer in this Python?
Tokenizer?
Yeah, for example, if there are multiple at the rate symbols in one particular string, so I want to tokenize it based on that at the rate symbols. ABC at the rate XYZ at the rate MNO at the rate something else. So I want to make it as ABC XY into one string, XYZ into one string.
XYZ. Basically, sorry, you are saying what is this
ABC
thing?
At the rate ABC at the rate XYZ. Put XYZ before Gmail.
Okay, XYZ, correct?
Yeah, at the rate
at the rate?
Yeah, MNO.
MNO, correct?
Yeah. So tokenizing
now
means
you want
we have to give three strings basically based on the token at the rate symbol. A, B, C in one string, X, Y, Z in one string.
Yes, so correct. Understood, understood. We have a different ways of doing that. So we have print S dot split at the rate.
Oh, wow. Okay. Split. Split is different and slice is different.
Yes. Split is the split method which takes the character based on which you want to split it. Slice is how you want to slice a particular string, like from which position to which position.
Okay. So there is no method as such slice, but it's a kind of operator, I think, right?
Yes. You can say it is an operator on the sequence you can apply.
Okay. Got it. Yeah. Thanks.
So,
Abhishek, everyone.
Sorry to interrupt. So, you mean to say that slice is being done on based on index only, and split is based on done on some character or something like that?
Yeah, split is based on the character, and slice will be based on the
index. Always on the index only?
No. Split will be based on the character.
No, slice.
Slice will be based on the indexing only. Means you can slice only based on the indexing. So there is no other way.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Anything else, guys? Any other question? In the indexing and slicing.
No. Not from my side.
So guys, I'm ending the meeting now. I have to leave. I'll be accepting this GitHub pull request, and tomorrow we'll meet again, okay?